evening. Welcome to a meeting of the Board of Education of the Somerset Hills. Please be advised that this and all meetings of the board are open to the public and media, consistent with the Open Public Meetings Act, and that advance notice required therein has been provided. This is a meeting of the Board of Education of the Somerset Hills, at which formal action may be taken. The public will have an opportunity to be heard as shown on the agenda. Would you please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We will do a roll call.
Mr. Baker?
Here.
Mr. DiGiacchino?
Here.
Mrs. Hubby?
Here.
Mrs. Leece?
Here.
Mr. McDonald?
Here.
Mrs. Palazzolo?
Here.
Mr. Palmer?
Here.
Ms. Suie?
Here.
Ms. Virtue?
Here.
Ms. Getz?
Present.
We just left an executive session we had in the principal's conference room for an hour to discuss matters which we cannot discuss in public. First item on the agenda is correspondence.
A thank you letter from a student, Caitlin Point, for a scholarship.
Next is the report of the superintendent.
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. So tonight, before I actually give the report of the superintendent, or maybe as part of the report of the superintendent, we'll start to include this, we have our student representative, Freddie Lucky, joining us tonight. So I think that we should allow Freddie to go first, because you're a soccer player. You're a soccer player? Soccer player. So he's already been to practice and home, and now we need to, he can give his report, and he can ask any questions, and then we'll let him go home and take care of his homework. So, Freddie, why don't you come up, and maybe Sarah can give you the microphone there. Why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself, though, first?
Thank you, Dr. Wood. So, like Dr. Wood said, my name is Freddie Ludke. I'm a senior here at Vernon's. I live in Gladstone. I've been in the school district kind of on and off ever since kindergarten. I've spent the past 4 years here in high school, and I've had a great experience. And I'm going to be attending these meetings every month and kind of giving you a bit of a report on school life from the student's perspective. So kind of the three things I'll be focusing on are the student body, the student life, kind of the academic side of things, and then the athletic side of things. So in terms of student life, I'd say the biggest theme so far this year has been an increase in school spirit, which has been great. We had Spirit Week this week. It was USA themed, so everyone dressed in red, white, and blue. Our first football game was two Fridays ago, which was great. We have another one this Friday. We're going to be announcing the homecoming court, which I think everyone's looking forward to. And we have the homecoming dance this coming Saturday, which is a casino theme. And then on the academic side of things, earlier this week, each grade had their class meetings. We reviewed class policies and senior meeting, went over our senior privilege rights, kind of prepared for some things at the end of the year. Also today on AP Economics, we had a speaker come speak with us, Michael Goodwin, who actually wrote our summer assignment reading. So that was a really neat opportunity to come and ask some questions and hear what he had to say. We also, the new AP class that's been launched, AP Computer Principles, which I'm actually taking right now, is going great. Our first assignment are a set of debates about privacy, technology, innovations, and Mr. Jones has been doing a great job with that. And on the athletic side of things, like Dr. Wood said, I'm a soccer player. So far we're 4-1. I know the cross-country football and tennis teams have had some very good results, but I think each of them are making strong for this year. So that's about it for today. I'd be more than happy to answer any personal or general questions. I'm looking forward to getting to attend these meetings this year.
Thanks.
Are there any issues specifically that the students have asked you to bring to the board? Do all the students know that you're going to be coming to our board meetings?
Mr. Nagel actually let me know that I'd be coming here fifth period today, so.
Well, let me just clarify though, two things. First of all, he has to go through the principal, because it's not appropriate protocol for a student just to bring things to the board. But I know what your intent was, though, but I just want to clarify that for the public. Secondly, though, but you didn't tell the whole story. You were chosen, but the principal had them do an essay about why they wanted to have this position. So Mr. Nagel was not thinking that we would want to get it going this early, so he thought maybe he would prepare the student and get ready for October. And I said, no, September, just because we should kick it off in September and get it going. So he said, well, I'm not sure, because, you know, Freddie's got soccer and this and that. And I said, well, just see if he'll come. So that's why I'm thanking you, because I didn't want the board to think I was putting them off. So thanks for making me look good, Freddie.
To come to the meetings, stay at the meetings, or is your plan to just come, present?
Yeah, he's going to leave.
Just a point of clarification, though. There's no restriction on anyone making a comment in the public comment period.
No, not at all.
Just wanted to get that clarified. Freddie, thank you very much for coming. This is awesome. Are you going to stick to that kind of three sections sort of format?
Unless there's anything else.
That's great. And I just wanted to say, you know, I know Sarah is something, she was pushing for a while, so it's great to start out the year with Freddie here. And it's terrific, and you're super nice to take time away from your various AP studies and your soccer and everything to come in, so we appreciate it. Thank you.
But I have a question. Okay, I can't believe I'm going to bring it up, but I am. Barking.
Did you say barking or?
Yeah.
So can you give us the overview of the barking situation with seniors and the lottery? And 17 people don't have the spaces.
Yeah, so we're limited in terms of space, but going from last year to this, so last year the policy was a year-long lottery. Students would apply late in the summer, and they'd either get a spot for the full year or they wouldn't. And in one of our student leaders meetings, where a group of high school leaders get to meet with Mr. Nagel on a monthly basis, we changed the policy to make them half-year slots, so everyone who applied and filled out the paperwork was able to get a spot for at least half the year. Obviously, that's not ideal for those that just get a half year of a spot, but I think it's a much better alternative to going a full year without that and having to park on in front of the Alcott building along that street.
So we were thinking, I was thinking, Mr. Nagel was thinking that maybe you can take this back to the student body. Maybe another restriction could be if you live within a quarter of a mile of school, maybe you shouldn't be able to get in a first lottery a parking spot. But I'm not sure how that would be received.
No, I think there's definitely been some students in the past who've been a bit displeased about, especially those that live in Gladstone and keep back in Bedminster, not getting spots, and kids who live right around the corner getting them. So I think that'd definitely be well received.
Okay, so maybe you can go take that back and get some feedback for us.
Yeah,
that'd be good to see. Okay, that'd be great.
Freddie, what about if we had this sort of two-tier system where lottery number one would be one family can only put in one application in the first round, and then you have to live greater than a quarter of a mile from the high school in the first round. And then whoever gets it. If there are spots left over at the end of the first round, anybody else who's left can put in for it. Do you think that would be a fair?
I think that's definitely a fair policy. I know there are some twins and triplets applied separately, and in some cases we're able to get multiple spots,
right,
but they're obviously not.
Right, so you think the students would perceive that as fair?
Definitely.
Are we finished with this topic? I just wanted to say that I am very impressed that you are here tonight. And I could not imagine either of my two boys doing this years ago, but I want to thank you. And if we ask you questions, never take it personally. It's just we want to be informed.
Other than the praise.
Freddie, you have three categories. Maybe your last category, fourth category could be issues that you bring to us from your peers.
Definitely.
Once he's talked to the.
Yeah, right.
I know, I have to keep saying that though, just because.
I'm sure you've been told the process, but yeah, once it goes through the channels, you know, things that people are complaining about or that they're happy about or whatever.
Yeah, and I forgot to mention this, but I am involved in student council. So I'm going to be meeting with them, with a group of student leaders, and then before each of these meetings, getting together with Mr. Nasser to go over.
Great, thanks, Karen.
Thanks.
Nice job, Fred.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming on cold.
It's a meeting.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Great job.
Very good.
Nice job.
Okay, so we do have a few things for the superintendent's report. First, let me get the.
Run, Freddie.
That's not nice to him. I think I'm not sensitive. All right, so the enrollment figures. Let's see, at the Bedwell School, there are 623 students, at the middle school, 551, and at the high school, 837, and that should total up to 2011 students. And that puts us down 22 students from last year. So basically, and unfortunately, our national merit semifinalist, David Hawk, could not be with us tonight, but I did want to recognize him. He is the only national merit semifinalist that we have for this year. So it is extremely important that we do that. Academically, David is driven to succeed. He has demonstrated an unwavering commitment to his studies over the course of his tenure at Bernards High. He's passionate about the fields of math and science. He placed third overall at the Physics Olympics along with his teammates, and has been recognized as the New Jersey AP Physics One Science in the AP Physics Science League as well. Distinguished member of the National Honor Society, he partakes in a number of co and extracurricular activities at BHS, including fencing, marching band, and orchestra. He's also proud to be one of the founding officers of the BHS Minnow Tank, a play on the popular TV show Shark Tank. The Minnow Tank, yeah, it is cute. The Minnow Tank is a student think tank where members develop innovative ideas with the goal of developing successful businesses. Ever impressive, David finds time in his busy schedule to provide volunteer hours to organizations such as the Children's Museum and the Center of Art in Bedminster. Most recently, David was honored as a semifinalist in the National Merit Scholarship Program. And this designation serves as a true testament of his talent and exceptional academic standards. So unfortunately, he could not be with us here tonight, but I did want to recognize him and say a little something about him. And part of what we recognized was his participation in the marching band. And next month, it was too late to get it on this time, but the marching band won first place in the first competition of the year out in Hunterdon Central at the Cavalcade of Bands, which if you know anything about the marching band, that is a tremendous, tremendous honor. That is really difficult to get. So first time out, they brought home the number one trophy. So we will be definitely recognizing them in October. I sent them an email and they said they wanted to come in October. So we'll be doing that.
Can they bring their instrument?
They're on it. I think they have selected, I asked Fred how he wanted to handle it because I was thinking the same thing. Okay, how do we do this? So yeah, they're going to figure something out so that we can recognize them. So that's very nice to get out of the gate with something like that. And now Jen's going to give us the academic report because we'd like to fill the board and the public in on the targets and the topics that we're focusing on academically this year.
Okay, so this is what just these are the highlights of our 2016-2017 school district initiatives. Our curriculum committee probably knows many of them. And some of them Freddie also highlighted here tonight. So we're completing the implementation of the grade eight connected math program, so that was our three-year phase-in for the new middle school math program. We also, according to the state schedule, we are implementing the next generation science standards in the middle school and high school this school year. Next school year will be the elementary school with those new science standards. We're offering the new AP Computer Science Principles course, which is an interesting course that's not only about coding, but it's really about like design, and it's supposed to bring other perspectives to use of computer science in other fields. So thinking about it in design work with architecture, with clothing design, those kinds of things. We're offering the wellness course to all fifth grade students. That's a pilot this year. We're implementing the Spanish course to all the grade levels at Bedwell. So all grade levels at Bedwell now receive a section of Spanish once every 7 days. There are more strategies now for differentiating instruction. That was a curriculum project for the summer for the middle school social studies. We have a lot of special needs students in those classes, and we're looking to encourage them more in the class and make sure that they have support. We're also beginning to explore the needs for one-to-one technology, and recently the staff began to fill out a survey to figure out what their needs were, and you know, whether our Chromebooks are meeting their needs or would there be another device. So we've gotten about half the staff so far respond, so we're hoping by the end of next week we'll have everybody respond.
But explain what we do now, because we have a lot of new board members.
Yeah, so right now we have Chromebooks, and we are almost at the one-to-one, I think, Nancy, right? We have enough Chromebooks around to do some of the things that we need to do, for instance, for part testing. And that allows us to run part testing in 1 week. Remember, originally we had started part testing on multiple weeks. We have enough computers to condense that testing, which is great for our instruction, so that we don't have many, many days of testing. We now can do it in 3 or 4 days. The teachers have Chromebook cards in their classroom. Teachers that wanted them, especially in the English department and other areas, have them accessible. At present, according to the survey, most teachers feel like they have good access for the Chromebooks. We have some possible funds to, you know, offer even more classes with Chromebook cards if they need them. So people are feeling like they can access these Chromebooks.
Well, part of your survey, though, is like it's the next steps, because those of you that haven't been on the board, and we didn't roll out a one-to-one initiative because of a number of reasons. First of all, we wanted to make sure that the teachers were buying into the technology, because it's driven by them. So we thought we would ask them what they wanted to do. And what they wanted to do initially was have, for the most part, the Chromebooks, and the younger kids, the iPads. So almost every classroom has a cart of the Chromebooks. And if they didn't want a cart, then obviously we didn't force one on them. So that was where we were at with it, but kids weren't taking it home, one-to-one, but that was 2 years ago. So now Jen sent out another survey to say, okay, how about now? Has anything changed? Do you still want the Chromebooks? You know, how are you using them? What, you know, basically, what are you using them for? If you didn't have these, what other devices would you like? And do you want to go one-to-one? So that's what we're waiting to get back from them, to see the direction that they want to go in, because it's really been a very positive endeavor. There's a lot of times when If you just roll it out from central office, you know, I mean, we're not in the classroom, we're not the ones teaching. So, you know, Jen's been great about all the professional development and the tech team and grants. So everybody's had so much immersion with technology now, that now we're rolling out the survey to see, what about now? You know, what can we do now? So that's what we want to get back, and we'll share with you what they think the next steps are, and then we can talk about it and see where we want to go.
Do you want me to finish the initiative first, or you want to talk about one-to-one?
Just one quick question.
Sure.
Do I remember correctly that Chef helped to fund some Chromebook purchases?
Originally, yeah, couple years ago. Yeah. I did fund some.
Thanks.
You have more on.
Yeah, a few more initiatives. Yeah, just I'll finish this, and then we can come back to some of these. We also have a district goal of improving questioning and discussion techniques, and on the opening day, we had a workshop for teachers, and the administrators will be assessing that skill through our observation process. Our DEAC just met to discuss that. We're creating more effective PLCs. We have more time this year for professional learning communities with our half days. On the opening day, principals led a workshop for teachers to discuss how to make more effective PLCs that would impact our teaching and learning through teacher collaboration and really sharing and diffusing knowledge across the district. So questions about that?
Yeah, my question is when you're doing a survey, and you know, maybe incorporate this or you could have it for the incremental surveys, but there were some anecdotal comments about connectivity, particularly in the middle school. And you know, the Chromebooks are great, but it's all requires network connectivity. And so, you know, we heard stories last year that the connectivity was so bad that the Chromebook couldn't be used.
Right.
So I just want to make sure that we're kind of
We can check again to see. I thought it was fixed, but we should check again to make sure that.
Yeah, I kind of heard some things still, but I mean, you know, as long as it's on someone's radar, because you can invest in all that hardware,
right.
But those things are by definition netbooks. And if your connectivity is down, then they're useless.
No, you're absolutely right. I believe it was fixed then, so there was one hallway.
We increased it by, I don't remember exactly.
You increased bandwidth into the building. But that doesn't, that doesn't translate into wireless connectivity. I think that's what you have to check. I know we upgraded it to 500 megs or something.
That's what you're talking about. You need airports. Need the airports.
Yeah, I mean, it's just whatever the Wi-Fi network is, it needs to make sure that it's distributing that upgraded bandwidth throughout the building.
I'll make sure.
Yeah, that's all. I don't want to get too deep.
We have dead zones. People have access. Yep.
Dead zones.
I believe it was, but I'll double check on it.
My question is about the PLCs and those six extra half days. I know there was some discussion about what the intentions were to give teachers more time to deal with the state mandated things that they had to do. Do we know how many of those 6 days are going to be dedicated towards professional learning communities? And is it going to be split half time for teachers to get their things done?
So three of the half days are for teachers to make their own decision about the use of the time. So they have to have an SGO, a number of them have two SGOs, which are student growth objectives, and you know this as teacher. And then also they do have to be involved in PLC and be working collaboratively on that. So three of them are by our directive, so we have one half day coming up here on September 30th, and there are a number of different things that are happening. So there's some training for the social studies teachers at the middle school, the AP teachers are meeting here at the high school, and then some people will be using that time for their PLCs.
3 days and 3 days, is that?
3 days and 3 days.
That will carry out through the next 2 years as well.
That's you know what has been communicated to me.
That's what was negotiated.
I have a question. I'm not that familiar with the Chromebooks, but the technology lab that we have, do they interface with the? Not a techie. I'm sorry. Sorry. But, I'm just wondering, like, when the students use the Chromebooks, can they then
So it's a web-based device.
Whatever you use on the computer can it then transfer over?
Yes. It's a web-based device.
Got it.
It's supported by Google, so a lot of the Google platform is worked through Chromebook. So, right, if you wanted to send a document to your lab or to an Apple computer, you absolutely could do
a lot of money off that lab, so it's good.
Awesome. So I have one question. You mentioned, we're talking about the special learning community, and then you said
professional learning community? Yes.
Special. What did I say?
Professional.
Oh, professionals are details, yeah. There's 3 days where you're leading courses.
So we create the agenda.
Create the agenda, and then the other 3 days the teachers decide to, they say, I need help in this area, and how does it work?
So we haven't done it yet, but what I'm picturing is that I will say to the teachers, this is your time to use to get through your work that you need to. So for instance, your SGO. Some teachers may still want to get together with their PLC or their grade level group, but it's up to the teachers how they'll use that time.
What can I just add to that? I know that seems like it's vague, but we also discussed in curriculum that they will fill out, you know, how they did use their time, and they're going to, it'll be a formal, it'll be formally fed back to the administrators on specifically what they have worked on, and it really is, as an educator, you know, we do have goals and we do set goals, you know, and the time that is spent on those half days, you know, you do research, you do set out an objective, and that objective is worked on, and then you will do a write-up for the administrators and followed up by the administrators to them. So there is feedback being given, so it's not just like a free-for-all.
Administrators will be in the building to help teachers. There may be something that they'll need to do their work on that day.
So it is basically a follow-up on their SGOs.
SGO.
Student growth objective. That's all I have. That's the entire report.
All right, so we'll move on to public questions and comments. This time we'll take any public comments about items on the agenda. There'll be a time at the end of the meeting to talk about anything that's not on the agenda. All right, so the next item, nobody from the public, okay? I didn't know you were standing up, okay? And so the next item is approval of the minutes from August 24th. And we were all given a revised minutes with a few things left out, so that they're noted in bold. I'll make a motion to approve the minutes. Do we have a second? Move seconds. Any discussions? Seeing none, we'll do a roll call.
Mr. Baker?
Yes.
Mrs. DiGiacchino?
Abstain.
Mrs. Hoppe?
Abstain.
Mrs. Lease?
Yes.
Mr. McDonald?
Yes.
Mrs. Palazzolo?
Yes.
Mr. Palmer?
Yes.
Ms. Suey?
Yes.
Ms. Virtue?
Yes.
Ms. Gibbs?
Yes.
Next item is the Finance Committee. The Finance Committee did not meet in the last month. We're still going to probably meet in November to start about the budget preparation for the coming year. So we'll do that. And so with that, I'd like to move items 1 through 5.
Second.
Any discussion on 1 through 5? Seeing none, we'll do a roll call.
Mr. Baker?
Yes.
Mrs. DiGiacchino?
Yes.
Mrs. Hoppe?
Yes.
Mrs. Lease?
Yes.
Mr. McDonald?
Yes.
Mrs. Palazzolo?
Yes.
Mr. Palmer?
Yes.
Ms. Suey?
Yes.
Ms. Virtue?
Yes.
Ms. Gibbs?
Yes.
Next on the agenda is the Curriculum Committee.
Well, we've been talking about curriculum all meeting, so I feel like I have to limit my comments on curriculum. So, except at the time, I'm limiting my comments, unless, of course, I get inspired by something. But I'm glad to see it, because that's the purpose of the Board of Education, to talk about teaching and learning. So I'm glad to hear that. Glad to see it. It's all good. One thing that we talked, so we met on September 13th, and we, Grant Colmer came in to talk to us about park data. We reviewed the park data. But I'm not going to really go into it at this point, because I think it's for, he's going to come in and give up the same presentation that he gave to the curriculum committee. You know, we reviewed and talked about it. He's going to give it to the entire board. So it's sort of redundant to really talk about it. It's, you know, basically we're doing fine.
So
and
he's going to do that next week?
That's in October, yeah. He's going to do it the next week. So I'll just leave that at that point. And, you know, information is going to be, once he presents it to the Board of Education, which is prepared to do, then all the information will go out to the parents. They're still getting the individual reports, and that will be mailed out to parents about their individual students. And if they didn't take the test and they opted out of it, then they still get sort of like the generic form of what the school is doing and things like that. And then if your child did take the course, then to take the test, then they'll get it in their individual report. So I just wanted to say that. The other thing we talked about was classes and class sizes. That's what we do every year. We get a report about, we just look at the class schedules for, and you know, just really look at enrollment, just sort of seeing if things were, you know, you know, sort of like the first, for example, the AP class that was taken, you know, whether or not you really did enroll in that, and just sort of just monitoring class level. We had a little bit of a discussion, just as far as, you know, some of the classes that just seemed oversubscribed a little bit at the middle school, but just sort of really what our range is for, you know, what we want to do. And I mean, some people may think that there's people, people in the community come and say, why do you have 30 kids in the classroom, 35, you know, and then sometimes educators, I have a life committee, which I love, we have educators on, you know, they point out, they look at that number, they see 27, they go, ah, 27, you know, so, you know, we just sort of explain it, I mean, you know, just sort of, you know, we don't have set, we have guidelines, we don't really have, you know, particular policy about an exact cutoff date. In general, we try to keep Bevel's enrollment around 20, you know, sometimes it's a little bit less, sometimes it's a little bit more, but that's sort of what we have, you know, what we have. Sort of feel that that's ideal. Sometimes in fourth grade they get a little bit larger.
Can I finish a little bit?
What?
14 to 15,
right? And for the high
school. Can I finish?
Anyway, and then at the middle school, we generally shoot around that 25 number. In general, just to try to keep those classes in literacy, it's a little bit lower just because there's a lot of writing that's done in those classes. So, I mean, I generally think that, you know, we try to shoot for like a 20 number in those classes. Sometimes, again, like you notice, like in the, you know, the social studies or in some of the other classes, sometimes those numbers are a little bit higher. Again, that gets a little bit complicated because we're team teaching, and so the seventh grade social studies teacher teaches all seventh grade social studies. So, you know, the science teacher teaches all the science, and unless you have a particularly large class, and it's never really good for the students or the teacher, because a lot of times we've had to have teachers in the past. Sometimes it's done in the general literacy in the class where they taught, you know, different grade levels, you know, maybe the same content area, but they say that they taught different grade levels. And it's always difficult because the way we structure our middle school is that we do, you know, they meet their team time and they all get to meet together with the team. And if you're teaching seventh grade most of the time, but you're teaching eighth grade, a lot of times you can't necessarily meet that during that team time. So, you know, we, you know, all those things, you know, factor into it, but I just wanted the board to know that that's something that we generally, we always every year look at it, you know, look at it. At the high school, I think we also, similar to the middle school, I think we sort of, we try to shoot for that 25 number, if at all possible. Again, sometimes things are limited, some of the music classes or some of the, sometimes they can be larger or smaller depending upon what they are. The technology, you know, the science classes, for example, we can only have as many kids in the class as we have stations for them to do experiments and things like that. So we sort of look at that as well too. Again, with the literacy, just because there's a lot of, you know, writing involved too, you know, really trying to look at those numbers as well too. Just so the board knows what we always do, and Franny has been a great implementer of this, and we've sort of always had that policy, guideline, it's not really a policy guideline, just that we really wanted to look at what our minimum number of classes are, you know, just because we do have a fair amount of singletons, and that always complicates the high school schedule, complicates, you know, hiring and things like that. So we really try to shoot for that 15 number as a minimum. But for example, I just, and I think I said it to the board again, so forgive me for repeating it, a lot of times what we will do is for an upper level language class, if a child's taken, you know, Latin or Spanish or French, you know, since sixth grade, you know, and just because they're a senior, they want to take that 4 year of, you know, of a language, which is very important. It's getting more and more important at school. To have that 4 years of a language, if that's a small enrollment, we would still go with that because we made a commitment to those students to offer those classes. Spanish, we really don't have that problem in. Generally, sometimes we have that problem in Latin. And, you know, and I think French is actually more, you know, more subscribed on to. So we try to make that commitment to the students to offer those classes, whether it's an AP class or an upper level class, that we try to, you know, allow that student to be able to take that fourth year of a class just to, because there would be no other class for them to take. So. We want to, you know, we sort of make an exception with that. And some of the other things we've made exception, we really try to build up the computer science classes in the district. So when we offered like the new AP, you know, computer science, we were allowing a little bit more flexibility for students to take the necessary prerequisites. And, you know, so some of those numbers might not always be as high as, you know, we hopefully they will be in the future. That's something that, you know, the curriculum supervisors continue to monitor, and our curriculum director continues to monitor, but the board, we also like to look at that too. So we feel like we're agreeing. We're going to talk about, we took off from all the information, so I said to the committee, let's look at it, review, and we'll come back next October, you know, in the next meeting. If there are any, you know, issues or stuff we want to discuss a little bit more, we can do that at that time. But generally speaking, I think what we looked at that time, we were pretty much on the mark of what we wanted to accomplish. So And the last thing we talked about, Jen just informed us about our professional, sort of what was going on with our, the professional learning, but she's already communicated that, she said, I don't really need to repeat that. She did much better job than I would have done, and just our curriculum goal, our committee goal for this year is aligned with the district, and that's, we're gonna continue to support ongoing professional learning opportunities to continue to improve teaching and learning throughout the district. So, you know, that's the business that we're in, we're not an air, you know, we're not an airlines, airlines flying airplanes. School, you know, school districts, they're supposed to make sure that their business is teaching and learning, so that's what that's what we do best here, we do a hell of a job here, and we'll continue to do that in the future, so. That's all I have to say, our next meeting's in October, so I'm gonna move forward. I think one, there was an addition to two, I think there's one issue, there was some things on the agenda, just some additional things that again, the board can, we really have included, Freddie, I appreciate that you've done this, you've sort of directed you to do this in the past, is just to really let the board know all the different things that our staff members are doing, all the different meetings, and you know, different professional training, professional learning that they're taking advantage of, and so we appreciate that our staff continues to want to be lifelong learners. Sure. Any questions? Oh, Director Moody first?
Yeah.
I know. Why don't you say something? Why don't you say something? How many? One or two? I move it.
Second.
All right. Any questions or comments?
Okay. So, I guess I was the one that brought up numbers because I guess when I saw 28 in a class in middle school, and I taught middle school for like 12 years, I thought that at some point, like social studies, it might not be educationally sound to have that many people in a classroom. I thought that was a lot. So I think what I was thinking of doing is going to other school districts just to get an idea of how many were in their classes. I would think we would need a cap at some point as to how many should be in class, because I think as a teacher, that's what we need, a lot of kids.
Well, what I think we should do, Lindy, is we should ask maybe our personal supervisors just to really look into that, because you know a lot of times they're it'd be easier for them to get information. You know what I mean?
Sorry,
it's good to continue to monitor that. I will say it's from year to year, sometimes that number. You know, I agree. I you know, because I've always been a big proponent for lower class size. Not everyone always agrees with us as well, too. You know, there's people who differ in that. I'm a big proponent of that as well, too.
Yeah, it's like 22. There's a lot. There's so many different issues right now in society that we're dealing with, and with adolescents and children at this point, where we have to consider the whole child. And teachers at this point are not just educating them academically, we've also become counselors and mothers, fathers, and you know, there's a whole bunch that goes on to educating our kids. And when you have 28, 29, 30 in a classroom, it's just not educationally sound anymore. And the expectations of a teacher and the expectations of the student to learn the material, and the pressures in society, and the pressures of, you know, learning done. We were just talking about all the expectations that we need to get through college, right? You know, the pressures in college, the pressures to do well, the pressures of, you know, with the extracurricular, because it's just everything that we're tossing at them. I think we just really have to take a look at the numbers and see what we can do to help make it a little bit easier for the, not easier for the kids, but just to make
take it into consideration.
Yeah. To make them available to learn, let's put it that way. To help them.
I do want to address the students, and I think those are all excellent points for me. I do want the board to be, you know, I don't think that just so that they know, you know, it's not done haphazardly. You know, I think that I'm just saying that just for the rest of the board, we've talked about this. I'm just saying that you know, a lot of thought goes into it, and things just have to be weighed. Again, you know, sometimes, you know, you always try to err on the side of, you know, providing the best education you can for students, and sometimes, you know, you know, you have to make decisions that may not always be perfect, but, you know, sometimes they're a year kind of thing, like I said, for in particular, this year, it's a very big class in eighth grade. Next year, it's a much smaller class. So if you hire another teacher to really be able to fill in a lot of time, it'll be a part-time teacher. You know, there's a different consideration. There's always a monetary aspect, you know, to that, that the board would have to consider. So we really sort of look to our administrators, our supervisors to monitor that just. And I do think that they do bring that back to, but what are the needs? And, you know, we have to hire additional staff as requested as time has gone on, you know, whether they've been, you know, for a different job, so English language learners or different things, you know, we've had more social studies lectures, but we've had to add on a part-time to a full-time position, so I think we continue to do that. But, you know, it's important that we're on top of it, and we keep on, you know, trying to, you know, make sure that we're offering the best possible education that we can.
Has our population increased throughout the years? I mean,
It depends on what they're taking sometimes. I mean, not so much at the middle school, but we're sort of down.
Like, I mean, we have 2,000 kids now.
No, we're pretty
down.
We're down 22 kids this year. But, you know, last year we were a little bit, you know, it just depends. I mean, yeah, we used to be a demographer, and it was actually pretty good.
Yes, we did.
Yeah, not really good. So, you know, I think our enrollment has stayed pretty consistent. You know, sometimes we get to reconfigure, you know, again, we get to reconfigure, like, for example, we hired more science teachers because a lot of our students have been just doubling up on sciences. You know, it's been we try to address that as well too.
And just to, so that people don't get a wrong point of view, most of these classes, the numbers are all over the place, and there are a few that are a little on the high side. It's not like every class is so high. I don't want people to get the wrong impression about that.
No, I'm sorry, I apologize if I conveyed that at all. I mean, I don't think either one of, I think we both, we're just noticing that there is sometimes,
right,
like, you know, you always get, you know, nervous about it, that's why we ask our administrators to adjust their bubbles.
But if you have 28, then if you get another teacher, then there's 14 in each class.
But that's always the thing, and sometimes we have a class to say too.
Everything.
Well, and sometimes, you know, for example, you know, you do a specialty, you're the, and I don't want to say that, but for computer science, for example, you know, you have one teacher that teaches that. So, you know, if you had I don't even know if that's even the right system, just you did an example of something where you might just have one teacher, or a psychology class, you know, when you have one teacher who teaches that, you know, you sort of, maybe there's more than a teacher now, but anyway, you sometimes, you know, you try to fit in, you know, we have 32 is always a tough number, you know, or 31 is always a tough number. So do you have 15 and 14, you know what I mean? Do you split it up, or you have 15 and 15? You know, it just gets a little bit, you know, sometimes, and then it has to fit into the schedule as well, too. So there are things, you know, but I think that we're doing a much better job of monitoring that. You know, there was, when we first got the board, there was a lot of, you know, really, you know, not really, you know, there were a lot of really overextended classes, and there were a lot of classes that really, you know, didn't really, they're really low enrollments in them. So I think we do a much better job. We try to, you know, Freddie and Jen spend a lot of time with them when they're doing the master schedule, just to make sure that there's something we can do to juggle it, and to make sure that we really optimal, you know, that we could really sort of get the best bang for, you know, bang for a buck.
Two questions. First one about the size of classes. Do we still co-seat like two levels?
We don't do that anymore.
Okay.
It's really not, you know, like,
yeah.
It's really not educationally sound. The feedback from the teachers and the students was that wasn't really productive. We used to do that in languages, for example.
Right.
You don't really do that anymore because it's just not solid.
Second question, I don't think you can answer this because maybe you can.
No.
But it has to do with the field trips that we're approving. It goes back to the question I have every once in a while. It comes up when I look at the cost of the field trips. And there's one on here, and I'm not opposed to any of the field trips, let me get that right out of here. But you have like the ski trip going to Vermont, and you have 10 chaperones, a faculty, and a nurse, and the students are paying for everybody. So I don't see how that really, you know, if you look at the breakdown of the cost per student, that's including 10 chaperones, a faculty, you know, they're paying for 11 people and the cost of their trip. So if I'm looking at it correctly, so if
no,
I'm not, then,
I don't know, is that right? I mean,
so 10 chaperones for 16 kids.
Yeah.
Or, you know,
it seems
like,
parents,
right? Well, but if you look at the cost, if you divide the cost for 16 students into the cost of the trip, they're paying for the chaperones. If I'm looking at it.
Can you tell us which
cost? Oh, it's the ski trip.
Yeah, no, I looked at that one too. I know.
So I and it's the bigger question.
I think it's
I'm sure it is, but the way this is written, it looks like the students are paying for all the camp chaperones, and I'm sure that's.
No, the parents are.
But if they're all parents of the students, that's one thing, but if it's students that are, if they're chaperones, they're just.
Because remember, you just gave the money to the school.
We did, I know that.
That's for transportation.
That was for transportation.
Yeah, pretty sure, that's what.
But I'm pretty sure.
But it goes to my bigger question, the cost of trips for, you know, these, the cost for, you know, a lot of these overnight and long extended. If somebody's on a ski team, they can't afford $500.
I'll ask the coach who the chaperones are.
I'm sure it's the parents, but the way this is written, it looks like, you know, there's 11 people that the students are paying for. I'm sure 10 of them are the parents that are going with them.
Yeah, I mean, you know.
I think the bigger question on this is that you're looking at the equity of the cost of some of these activities.
The trips, right.
Well, every year we bring that up in policy, and everybody kicks it to every other committee.
Well, we talk about the same.
No.
So curriculum kicks it to policy, and policy kicks it right back to curriculum.
No, we always say we're okay with it, because we feel like you don't have to be a part of, the problem that we get sometimes is with classes that are required, you know, like some of the music classes and stuff like that. You know, you have to take that, and then there's a lot of additional costs, like that, I mean, I sort of have more problem with that. You don't have to be on the ski team, you choose to be on the ski team. So I think that that's inherent, skiing is, like, you play ice hockey, it's an expensive sport, you know, I mean, so it's, you know, there's some sports that are just more expensive, you know, than others, and, you know, unfortunately, you can't ski, and, you know, even though there's a little mountain and peak class or a little hill, whatever you're talking about one time, you know, you're not taking, you're not learning how to ski there, whatever that little hill is, or whatever the heck it's called. You know what I'm saying? We are, and I didn't know when I was educated. I'm proud of it too. I think it's great, but you have to go to Killington to learn how, you know what I mean? I'm sure that that's what they might do. So it's always, you know, you always wait, but you don't want to deny opportunities to kids. I mean, it's just, you know, we've done a lot of the, you know, Nike sports, you know, Hampton lacrosse, and softball, a lot of the baseball I've done.
I just do attend chaperones. I'm sure it's the parents, but I think that, you know. I'm sure.
So get worst case, you listen when we need us.
I know.
When we read these field trip requests, and on number 8, it always says total cost of the trip. Some are zero, some are $7,000. Does this form indicate whether that's, those funds have been raised by the individuals or?
Yes, it tells you where the funds come from.
Where does that?
If it's from the district or the.
Okay, sir, got it. Thanks.
So the nurse is pretty expensive on this trip.
We have to have a nurse.
Oh, I know, I'm just saying.
No, I'm just saying, that's, and sometimes it's always a problem, is a lot of times the kids, you know, like, they don't need, you know, whatever, they don't have anyone, you know, but.
You know, somebody's trying to share the nurse, so they're going with spring.
You talked about the $7,000.
It's a big percent.
See, my question is, like, the chaperones from 5 to 12, you only need one chaperone. For 15 students, you only need one chaperone. So you have 16 students, you have 10 chaperones.
I bet those parents want to have.
So I'm sure they do, but then it should be something that's one chaperone and then 15 parents, and they're paying their own way or whatever. I'm just checking.
You know, in all fairness, I think she might have also, this is a, you know, case, you know, the parent who isn't a teacher who's filling this out, you know, the form, and, you know, it could have even been, those are just people that are coming along on the trip, you know what I mean? Like, I think it was just, you know, it would be nice to have a little bit more information on that, because I just, like, I have a feeling that that's really not, you know, they're not absorbing the cost of all.
I'm gonna ask.
We'll find out. Any other questions on the curriculum resolutions? Seeing none, we'll do a roll call.
Mr. Baker?
Yes.
Mr. DiGiacchino?
Yes.
Mrs. Hoppy?
Yes.
Mrs. Lees?
Yes.
Mr. McDonald?
Yes.
Mrs. Palazzolo?
Yes.
Mr. Palmer?
Yes.
Ms. Suie?
Yes.
Ms. Virtue?
Yes.
Ms. Getz?
Aye.
Next is facilities and operations, that goes to Mr. Palmer.
Yes, we did have a meeting earlier tonight. We had a request from the baseball team for us to look into putting a flagpole on the lower field where the baseball and softball fields are. So we are gonna, we're gonna look into that. They wanted to donate some money towards that flagpole, the baseball booster club. So we are gonna look at the cost of installing a flagpole on a lower field and a placement of where we can best put a flagpole on that lower field. So we will look into that, and we'll be getting back to the full board for an approval. Yes?
I know I'm not supposed to ask any questions about this, but it's gonna be in the middle of the softball and baseball.
That was our discussion about the placement of it. So, you know, we wanted to share, see where it would be in a good spot down there. So we will get back to you as to what the cost will be and where the placement would be, and make sure everybody's happy with the placement of the pole. We did discuss a noise level at Bedwell Middle School cafeteria. We did some renovations in the cafeteria, and a lot of the acoustical panels are either old or came down during the construction. So we did have a request, or we did have some concerns about the noise level during lunch period. So we're going to look into the cost of acoustical tiles or sound baffles or some kind of sound deadening in the cafeteria. So we will be getting back to you on what our proposal is to help that situation and a possible cost. Update on the major projects. At the last meeting, I said we would be ready by the time school opened. We were just about there. For the most part, we were substantially completed. The lighting and the railings are expected to be completed. Well, the railings, if you notice, are completed on the handicap ramp. It's not usable yet, but the railings are installed, and the lighting will be completed. It needs to be completed. The tube stanchion and the pollard lighting has to be completed. Work on the irrigation system is completed. Landscaping was done around the new handicap ramp and the grass seeded and all that, so that's getting back to where it was. In the old auditorium, the iron workers have completed about 70% of the steel decking for the balcony area in the media center. The electrical contractors, the coordination meeting, they have meetings regularly. Coordination meetings on that project tomorrow. I think tomorrow is the electrical coordination meeting for that project. HVAC, the heating and air conditioning penetrations and connections will be done this week, weather permitting, which I think we're going to have good weather to do that. We in the Alcott building, we have some repair work to the steam pipes. That should be completed today. It was completed today. We removed one of the dead spruce trees. There's a couple of new trees that we planted near the Alcott. One of those was replaced as part of their guarantee. We replaced the air conditioner in the Alcott conference room, and the second one needs to be replaced, so we're going to do that. So it'll be a little more quieter when we have meetings in that conference room. So that will be taken care of. The fire alarm system has been repaired at the high school. There was some wiring damage in the construction area, so it's all been taken care of. TDE Bank is not completed yet, but they're on their way. Access to the center has been a big concern of some of the board members. We did find a gate at the lower level of the softball field, so that's going to be unlocked. So there is an access that you can go right from the field to the side of the building and then down to the shopping center as an alternative to going down the TD Bank ramp. So once that's done, there'll be a couple access ways to get to the shopping center. Let's see if I have anything else. A transportation update. We still had some issues, or the biggest issue is a driver shortage. If anybody knows anybody that would like to drive a bus, we can find a spot for them.
Standard or automatic?
Yeah, I'm sure they're automatic, but you have to have a CDL license, a special license.
That's not that bad. My mother-in-law can do it. Anybody can do it.
And we have a new software system for the bus, for the bus routes. The biggest one, we have food service state review, which I think Nancy could probably discuss better than I, but every so often, we have an administrative review of our school nutrition program. So that's going to be happening sometime this year, which Nancy will be heavily involved with, I'm sure. And the last one is the bid awarding for the classrooms down in the old media center, which is one of our addendums tonight. We did go out for bid, and we have a bid which I'm going to ask the board to approve for $767,700, which was the low bid. The high bid was $1.1 million, and the bid that we're accepting is approximately $350,000 less than what we anticipated it to be. So we're coming in under budget on those bids. So I'm going to ask the board to approve awarding that contract tonight. And I do have another motion besides the two that we have on the agenda is the F&O number three, which is a HIB. That's the, we discussed the HIB in executive, so I'm going to ask her if we resolve that the Somerset Hills Board of Education reviewed the harassment, intimidation, and bullying case presented on September 21st, 2016, and upheld the findings and or consequences recommended by the superintendent. So I'm going to ask that to be number three. So I'd like to move motions 1 through 3. Any questions?
Seeing none, do a roll call.
Mr. Baker?
Yes.
Mr. DiGiacchino?
Yes.
Mrs. Hoppe?
Yes.
Mrs. Lewis?
Yes.
Mr. McDonald?
Yes.
Mrs. Palazzolo?
Yes.
Palmer?
Yes.
Ms. Sui?
Yes.
Ms. Virtue?
Yes.
Ms. Gibbs?
Aye.
Next is policy. First of all,
I'm sorry, I was not at the.
Oh, it was Jane, I'm sorry. Okay.
It's our debut.
Okay, the policy committee met last week to review the Strauss SMA, update some changes to the policies and regulations. The committee also discussed the removal of service learning as a graduation requirement, and the consensus was that many of our students do a great deal of worthwhile community service on their own, and it's something that's really difficult to keep track of as a senior service project, and we have to pay a teacher a stipend to do so. So we felt that removing this requirement makes sense. Another thing we discussed was removing a separate research paper as a graduation requirement. And we talked about how our students complete various writing assignments and papers throughout their whole high school process. And all these things are embedded in the curriculum, I mean, purposefully. So therefore, we don't really need a separate research project or research paper to be done senior year, because this is already happening in their core standards. So we see if that makes sense. And then one of the things that you might notice on the abolished policy pages here in this stack of things was Strauss SMA replaced the outdated term of in-service training to professional development, which is what we're always talking about. I was going to tack on the DAC committee update here. Okay, so the DAC committee, that's the District Evaluation Advisory Committee, met this week. And that committee only meets twice a year, so we'll see how that goes. But really, what we discussed in this meeting, And for those of you who don't know what that committee is, it's made up of teachers and administrators and a parent and a board member and student supervisors. So, well, and Jeff is there.
It's association.
Teachers. Yeah, right. So what we just really discussed the state suggested changes for teacher evaluations, and everybody pretty much agreed that those were fine. What the observational schedule would be is for
non-tenured teachers, they're going to have one long unannounced observation, one long announced observation, and one short unannounced observation. And for tenured teachers, they will have one short announced observation, one long unannounced observation.
Long announced for the tenured teachers and short unannounced.
Okay. No, that's what I had.
That's what I was asking.
Yeah. Oh, I did, okay, sorry. So everybody seemed to be on board with that. Anybody have any questions?
With the removal of service learning, what was the actual cost difference?
We have to move the second.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Make a motion, you're going to move items one and two.
Second. There you go.
That's it.
I'm sorry, you can second, so you can vote on policy. Somebody else can second.
Second.
Thank you.
For the removal of service learning, what was the actual cost difference? Was it already an existing teacher that just took on that role in addition to what they normally?
It's a stipend, and I have to look up the stipend amount, I don't know it offhand. But even more so than it being the stipend, the real reason that we wanted to abolish it as something that was required is because most of our students are already doing service learning, and it's meaningful service learning. And what we were finding was, and Nancy, you've been on the board, so you probably support this, that, or not, but I believe it to be true, that what we were finding was that most of the students were doing, like you said, meaningful service learning. Where we were having a problem was getting students who were just doing it because they had to do it to get service learning, and it became kind of meaningless. And we were like fighting the good fight for that when it wasn't a battle that we had to take on, because you heard Freddie up here. I mean, what was today? Today was and everything you're grateful for, and we already kind of have that embedded, and we just feel that philosophically that's who we are. And so to put it as something that's required as a credit kind of demeaned it in a way and made it less of what it is. And if it goes the other way, then we can certainly reinsert it, but at this point it's kind of counterproductive to do it.
Well, just my personal experience, I think it actually encouraged kids that wouldn't actually go out of their way. They really just, they said they have too much going on in their lives, and to actually go out and do that. And whether it was, mandatory or not, because it was mandatory, they ended up actually getting something out of it and say, wow, I actually want to do this more. So although their schedules are busy, I think it encouraged them. And it's something that I think every student should do. But that's
it came as the principal has been trying to recommend it to us for a couple of years, because of the reasons that I just said. I mean, I agree in principle with you. So I guess we're going to see where it leads us, because we were paying. I did look at the stipend, how much we're paying.
I think it was the monitors. I think it was
monitoring of it.
The problem was, I think, sir, there might be a few students that. Like that, that would be the thought, I think, behind it. It's like required,
right.
So students, I think that's why students do something that they wouldn't normally do, and so you encourage them and they do it more. What was happening was there was arguments about what really counted with some service. People were like, it really wasn't truly community service. It seemed like it's like the students who really want to do it, and that's the vast majority of our students do because they want to do it, not because they want to. It's almost like you get a little brownie point for being good. It's like, well, you should be good because you want to be good, not because you have to be, someone tells you, you get a credit for it. And so, thank you.
But we have to monitor. We have to look to see if what we're looking at right now, is that who we are, or are we going to, is it going to fall off? And do we need to reinsert it? But they've been, for a couple of years, saying, why do we have to do it as a credit when most of the kids are doing it anyway? So I don't know. You could argue.
Well, you have no way of measuring it.
Right.
Right. I mean, so, I'm a little confused as to what we're what's the benefit of dropping it, right? There's other, some stipend and some administrative issue.
It's a huge administrative situation.
Can you quantify the huge?
The stipend we pay for it, the stipend we pay the person for, really truly isn't even, it's not a lot of money for, you know, it's several thousand dollars, but to monitor the whole, you know, system of it, because it's a graduation requirement, so you have to make sure it's legitimate, so it's not just having someone turn in the hours, but you have to, you know, there's follow-up on it, there is, you know, providing opportunities for students who say, I don't know where I get my community service.
So is our concern that the burden, the administrative burden is too much? That's a different issue than, hey, everybody's doing it, we don't need to measure it anymore.
Well, I don't think they're mutually exclusive, so I think there's a combination of things that made a lot of people in the high school feel that, you know, we shouldn't really, you know, continue to pursue it. It wasn't like a one-year kind of thing where we all of a sudden decided to say, you know.
Just, it runs counter, right, to the logic of, well, we can take it away because everyone's doing it.
We're not taking away, we're just trying to find it as a requirement, though.
If it's an administrative burden to prove it, then people probably aren't really doing it, and we're kind of throwing in the towel.
Well, our desire to do that. Gordon has his hand up,
Go ahead, Bill, I'm sorry.
No, you're eliminating it as a graduation requirement. But are you still gonna have somebody monitoring the hours, because you have the Century Award, you have all those awards that you give out, it's, you know, when kids graduate, has to different levels of service. Now, how are we gonna monitor that and give those awards out and put their name on the plaques if they get 100 hours of service for the year? So you're still gonna have an administrative burden if you're still gonna give out the awards. So,
Well, not as much as graduation credit. Two different things.
Well, then, we're still going to monitor the service because, you know, I did 100 hours of community service.
Yeah,
I'm
going to
get my name on the plaque. So, I mean, who's going to monitor if it was worthwhile to meet the criteria of what we call service?
But not only kids, you know, there's a handful of kids who do that.
I understand. I mean, we must have had a reason to put it into place. So,
as a previous
and are we taking it away in the lower grades? I know they have to do a couple hours.
Well, it's not a graduation. We just took it out as graduation. That's it. So it's still embedded there. We just took it out.
So we're taking it out as a graduation requirement. Are we still going to have that they have to do a minimum of 10 hours? Or are you taking that away too?
That's not in policy. That's not written in the policy.
No, I understand. But I'm asking, we're eliminating as a graduation requirement, but are we still going to require 10 hours like we have 2 hours in the middle school with 3 hours?
Well, that's practice. That's not policy.
Well, that's
like you're going to still have a practice, or are we going to eliminate service learning in the school?
Well, I don't think we're going to eliminate service going out of high school either. Right. We're still going to encourage our students. And we wish everybody did 100 hours. You know what I mean?
No, I understand.
You know what I'm saying? You know, I think it's the number of the graduation requirement, because
we must have had a reason to put it in place, and I think it goes back to what Sarah was saying, that we wanted a minimum of 10 hours everybody to get some kind of exposure to doing service learning, and to expose them to something they may not have done if we didn't require it.
To
go out to a food bank, to go out to someplace, and whether or not we monitor it or not, I think, you know, we wanted them to go out and experience something that they normally wouldn't do, and might have a good experience doing that, and maybe follow through, and instead of doing 10 hours, maybe they would do 20 hours, or maybe get the 100 hours at the end of the year.
Well, maybe
so I'm just concerned about eliminating it.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying. If we kind of look at the evolution of it, and maybe this is part of what we're talking about, maybe. But years ago, when this was first implemented, it was not the thing to do community service. I mean, it just, people weren't doing it. And then we implemented it here, and certain amount of hours, and so on and so forth. But I think what we're saying now is that it's kind of become ingrained that we do this automatically, and so they have it for graduation requirements where we have to really follow through, et cetera, et cetera. I think that's why it was brought up. As far as I'm concerned, I could go either way on this.
Janice, I guess what I was saying before is that I think those are inconsistent logic paths, right? Either everyone's doing it and it's not a burden, or it's not really getting done, it's an administrative burden, and we want to remove the administrative burden by removing this graduation requirement. But you can't say that everyone's doing it and it's a big burden to kind of demonstrate. That's not logical.
Well, I can't say it, everybody, but I do think the mindset now is that there's more outreach, there's more community service. I mean, I could look back years ago, and you know, my kids are like 38, 40 years old now, right? Well, back, way back then, you know, it was a new thing to do community service. And so, but now, over the years, it's just part of our, I think it's become more part of our culture, and it just kind of evolved like that, where people just do it now. So maybe that's a little
Well, kind of speaks to what Lou had said, because in the lower schools, that's kind of, that's where they're introduced to it. So I guess, and I, you know, I've only been here for 4 years, but I mean, so by the time they get to the high school, it seems like it is part of, but I understand the other side of it too, though, that you want to make it a requirement because you want to make sure that if people aren't so ingrained, that at least they have the, you know, their exposure to it. But.
I agree with Sarah, and I agree with others here. Why is it ingrained? The reason it's ingrained is because we're doing it. And my question would be, that nobody here can answer, how long, if we stop it, does it stop being ingrained? I mean, I like the idea of students wanting to do it for the true intrinsic reasons they should be wanting to do it, not just for community service hours, but I can appreciate what Sarah's saying. Because she's gone through it. I never had community service in school, and so I appreciate Sarah's viewpoint. And I think if there's this much discussion, maybe we need to move a little more slowly. Maybe there's some kind of compromise that we can reach that would keep the board happy and together on this, and keep the program together as well. Because I don't think the other issue is not an important issue, but it's. You know, you're saying eliminate the stipend position. I'm not sure
if
that can happen and should it happen.
Well, I'm not even really, the stipend is
probably I think there's a compromise if you reach here that would make us all happy.
Because we're giving the award. The money thing.
You're putting the students in a bad position, because when I graduated, I did over 100 hours of community service. And you receive one of those plaques, you get to put it on your resume, but not only that, you send your resume to a college. I got $20,000 of scholarship because of that. What kid wants to pay $20,000 more of debt that you could potentially risk over one person's stipend when you're affecting a whole grade?
But you didn't have the hours to do nothing other than this graduation requirement, though.
Most
and the problem is that this is what the difference is.
That's
you
a lot of money.
You were going to do it because you were a good person. You wanted to. No one's not. We're not against community service. No one's against doing community service. And you're hoping by the time it's more of a record-keeping, you know, proposition. And you're saying that one of them, you know, they don't go hand in hand together. The truth of the matter is, most of our students do a lot of it. There is a fraction of kids who do not, for whatever reason, maybe they have to go home and take care of their sibling right after school. Maybe they do a lot of community service in their family, but that doesn't count for community service.
But maybe,
it's family
maybe
service.
The solution is to find ways to enable those guys to get community service that's actually legitimate, right? Instead of throwing up our hands and saying it's too much of a hassle, let's not make it a requirement anymore. Because it just seems to me like community service is an incredible part of that high school experience, and it's an incredible part of an individual's formative experience. And having it as part of the graduation requirement is a good thing. And if there's an administrative hassle about people who are not complying, let's make it easier for them to comply. But let's not say, because it's a hassle for that small number of people,
Let me finish, please.
What we're saying, it's not clear to me what the benefit is of removing it, other than an administrative burden, which I characterize as a hassle. Okay, so I don't see what the justification is for removing it. Just because maybe for a couple of people it's a hassle. I think it's an important part of the high school experience, and I don't think we should throw up our arms and drop it.
Right. And Sarah,
can I just clarify something?
Okay.
No, I just need to. Tim, I agree partially, but I see what you're saying. I just wanted to be clear, because we're on record, that I'm not saying it's an administrative term hassle. That's all I want to be clear about. Sarah, you're the most recent high school graduate on the board, and I wonder, you talked a little bit about how community service changed your life a little bit, but not only did you get that nice scholarship, which is great, I know that most students don't get that, but how did coming up as a community service student in middle school and then in high school when you really made a tremendous effort, probably because you had been exposed to it, and I would imagine there's a culture of supporting and encouraging community service. How did that change you as a person? Do you think as a teenager, if you didn't have to do it, you would have been quite as motivated?
I was actually a very shy kid in middle school and high school, and by doing community service, I used to volunteer at the senior center when I used to be in the chapel, and then moved over to Mount Airy. But starting off at a young age, you get to speak to people, you're basically forced to, but you learn from others. It's not just from the service itself, by, you know, paying forward and, you know, the whole concepts, which is great and all, but it's good for development as a person. It's good for learning about, you know, what people did, other generations, whether they're elderly, disabled, whatever type of service you may be doing, and a bad situation, feeding the hungry, mental illness, whatever it could range from. And that's something that people should be exposed to, especially in Burgerville. We have a great community that has very little poverty, and this is pure statistics. We have, how many homeless people do you see in Burnsville? Bedminster, Far Hills. And that's something that it forces people to be exposed to.
The demographics in our community are changing, and I do believe there's going to be more opportunities for the community service. I'll just speak to one example of what Sarah was saying and piggyback on what she was saying, and that's the intergenerational prom. There's a lot of kids who come to that prom, especially in the fact that it's in May, that do it because they need those community service hours. So they're doing it because they need hours. Everyone would like to think they're doing it because they want to interact with the seniors and all these good things that go along with that, but both of those things happen. They're kind of forced to go there because they need the hours, and then they get this tremendous experience that goes with that, and that's what Sarah's saying, and I agree wholeheartedly with her.
The two incidents that I remember, and this has been discussed over and over again since I've gotten here, I think the curriculum committee took this on a number of years, but there's two concerns that I've heard as an issue with it. One is those students that are economically disadvantaged. We do have a growing population of economically disadvantaged students who do have trouble finding that time to do that because they're already doing things to work, to maintain their own families, so that's been a concern for that group. And then the other concern is, what is community service? There have been a lot of disputes about what is community service, and people have gotten into considerable argument about community service. So those were the two things that I've seen as the issues, and I've heard it over and over again for a number of years. So
the determination of what constitutes community service, is that our interpretation?
Yes.
Well, I say ours, the district's interpretation,
yes,
of what it is, or is it some general?
Because we make it a graduation requirement, we have to determine what and define what community,
right,
service is. But
there, I know it's been restricted. It's been restricted quite a bit since it originally started. So maybe that's part of the issue. Is that part of the issue, or the problem too, as to what?
I'm trying. You know what? Here's my suggestion. I'm trying to get you want to get arms around this. Normally, we would say, in a case like this, let's think about it for a little bit more, but we can't, so, because it'd be unfair for the people in here. So my suggestion is, this is an issue that we need to look at this coming year, because I can vote either way. I can vote either way in this, because I have signed off on kids' projects. I had a kid last year that came to me at the 11th hour wanting to do a project. So I worked with them, I got the project done. So, and I do understand our climate change. So I think we need to look at this as a board during the entire year, get feedback from the community, from other administrators, and try to make a decision.
For next year.
For next year, before the school year starts. Either we're going to continue it, we're going to make the hours less, instead of 8 hours, it's 8 hours, right?
It's 10.
Or 10, I'm sorry. See, I'm thinking the old days, it used to be 8 hours, so.
It's just 10 hours.
So we can change that, or you could say, because this person has special, you know, circumstances in the family, they can't leave, so let's say we're going to leave it in. So I'm going to make a motion to keep the graduation requirement for service learning the same.
Have a full discussion.
And have a full discussion during the year.
So just let me clarify, when we look into it, what types of things would you like us to look at?
I think it would be helpful to come up with a guideline that is very clear so that there is no question of what constitutes community service.
I think there is one.
There is.
There is. I mean, that's part of the problem because a lot of people, for example, have felt, and again, this is whoever, you know, policy can take it up again, but that's one of the ongoing is this. There is a good part of our population that has to go to work after school, has to go home and take care of their younger brothers and sisters because their parents work. And so that doesn't count as community service because it's family service, you know, and that.
You can't document that.
It was just, you couldn't really document, you know what I mean? So that was burdensome.
So we'd like.
Troubling to what it was really hitting, something outside, in, you know, certain organizations and, you know, and it was what was wide ranging of what you could do it for, but there are some different requirements to it. So,
maybe
you want to change the definition
then,
of what community service
I reword that, and since there is an existing guideline that is good for students that are able to involve themselves in community service, perhaps then could we come up with a wording that addresses students that either have family situations that don't allow them the time to do traditional guideline-based community service, and how do we word that so that it's a.
Do you want different rules for different kids?
No.
I believe the question was to the board was that what are some things that Franny and the administration should think of? And so that is one consideration. If indeed there is a concise, clear guideline for community service, and one of the reasons that this policy has been considered to be dropped, because I thought I heard that there are students in the community that don't have the time to find community service that are traditional, Metheny, senior citizens, Golden Prom, because they have circumstances in their home that prevent them from being involved in getting to those
Yeah.
I'm talking too much. Is that helpful?
You know what I was thinking? The person who is in charge of this program, does that educator, I don't know who is in charge, does that supervisor, does that teacher help the students or guide them in any way, help them?
Usually they can find them places to work or do community. I mean, usually there's a big list of
like
places
if they see
that need
like
help.
The first or second semester that they're really slacking, do they meet with them and say, yo.
It's a very healthy discussion. I think it's very important. The reason it was put into the curriculum is for a lot of positive reasons, and I would not want to see us water down this whole thing and say and exempt people from doing it. I think what we need to do is what I think Tim alluded to is maybe find ways that would. Kids who don't have that time, we can find some meaningful ways for them to get those hours because I think it is important. And I don't want to water down the curriculum, and I don't want to water. This one particular program sets us apart from a lot of different schools, and I agree with a lot of members of this board, I would hate to see it go. So maybe either goes back to policy, or maybe we have a mixture of the board come up, you know, form an ad hoc committee that would study this, because I think it's just too important to just eventually.
Well, we get some numbers from the administration in terms of.
I like to know cost.
That's why I don't want to.
No, it's not the cost. Like, you should have people who are running into.
People just do 10 hours, maybe you should just bring that to the.
Or just we should discuss it further.
But it was, you know.
I think we're all in agreement, it makes a lot more discussion very complicated.
So we'll leave it, stay in.
Well, this is the first reading. The purpose of a first reading is to reject something you don't like. And so we're rejecting this change.
So, yes.
Is that clear?
Second, there's a question on another.
Sure.
Employment of chief school administrator. I know that's a Strauss-Esme policy. Is there a reason why, good questions, I guess, the reason why that's in? I looked at the policy, and that doesn't seem to be the complete policy from Strauss-Esme. I'm wondering, it seems like there's some things eliminated based on the same Strauss-Esme policy in other districts. What was the reason to eliminate some paragraphs and have in there in the first place? And I get back to the Strauss-Esme as a policy.
What are you talking about?
No, I think that.
Policy number 1220.
What?
I think the only thing in that was a couple of.
It's the first one.
The only thing that we looked at in that policy was you could put narrow things in for choosing a new superintendent that might, for instance, box us in as a board. So really, I think the spirit of what this was that it would be up to the board to decide our guidelines for what we're looking for when we're looking for new superintendents.
Okay.
But it was a mandate.
I printed them up so I can show them to you.
Yeah.
Printed up the same policy, Strauss-Esme policy number 1220, and it was longer by a couple pages. There's some things that we
this
removed.
Year's?
Sure.
We didn't remove anything.
Well, there's some.
You could have added something, right?
Okay, so maybe that. Yeah. So this was a complete Strauss-Esme policy, and then other school districts added things into theirs.
Yeah, you can add stuff.
We could have restricted ourselves. Okay.
So my question, I guess, is this is what Strauss-Esme gave us. So this is
yes, and we did not add any restrictions.
And
so
we didn't take anything out?
No.
Okay.
So that when the time comes for us to pick a new superintendent, we as a board can decide what our criteria are, and we're not locked into a policy that maybe you have the perfect candidate and then you have one thing, and then you're stuck because you made a policy.
Okay. What was the reason for even... Even if we didn't have this policy, we could certainly pick a new superintendent.
I don't know.
It's a mandated policy.
Okay.
For instance, we talked about, well, when we put in the requirements, somebody, the new administrator, must have a doctorate degree. Well, maybe this person that we're really interested in is just about to get their doctorate degree, but because we put that in our policy, we would limit ourselves and say, okay, that person who we really do want is out of the running. So that was why we decided.
The spirit was just sort of letting us decide what our guidelines are. And you know how when you're hiring somebody, as I've seen in the short time I've been here, depending on the year and the specific circumstance, your guidelines and what you're looking for might be different than they would have been 4 years ago. And so, you know, to make it more restrictive for us might hinder our search.
Well, I mean, yeah, my question was answered.
Yeah, no, this just came. I mean, this stuff just comes. It's not like you asked for it. And then you have to look at it.
Well, anything that has the M in the right-hand corner is mandated. So this was sent out in batch, that first batch.
And we could have added things, we didn't take anything out.
Okay, that was my question.
Okay. Some more questions? We will vote on the policies. And
so how are we doing that?
So
we're going to send that back to policy because it's the first reading. send it back to policy on high school graduation to put back in what was taken out. And during the year, we will discuss it further.
Okay, that's the community service component. What about that?
Well, it's all the same policy.
Oh, so just all of this, okay.
So I'll have Kathy redo it.
Just for the record, I think you made a motion, but I don't know if anybody seconded, but you want to just withdraw that because.
What about breaking out that?
I seconded, but I'm not allowed because it's policy.
And then I seconded it.
Just to take out number two, right?
That's a different, that's not, that's just the name of it. That's not what you're thinking it is. That's just changing the name of it.
What is that? It was a name.
That's not what you're talking about.
That's true.
That's for the teacher.
So can you just withdraw that motion because what we're doing is we're sending back 5460.
I will withdraw.
We're doing the same intent of what you said, which is, but we're sending it back to Morris.
Got it.
All right, roll call.
Mr. Baker?
Yes.
Mr. DiGiacomo?
Yes.
Mrs. Hoppy?
Yes.
Mrs. Lees?
Yes.
Mr. McDonald?
Yes.
Mr. Palazzolo?
Yes.
Mr. Palmer?
Yes.
Ms. Sue?
Yes.
Ms. Virtue?
Yes.
Next is personnel. Nancy?
Oh, personnel, we met. And we talked about personnel. So I'm going to put forward motions and we can't talk about it, so we go.
One through what?
Go through, want to see there any candy in the session?
You're doing it one through 14.
One through 14, thank you, Bob. Sorry, put forward motions, one through 14.
Second.
Any questions? Roll call.
Mr. Baker?
Yes.
Mr. DiGiacomo?
Yes.
Mrs. Hoppy?
Yes.
Mrs. Lees?
Yes.
Mr. McDonald?
Yes.
Mrs. Palazzolo?
Yes.
Mr. Palmer?
Yes.
Ms. Sue?
Yes.
Ms. Virtue?
Yes.
And Ms. Gibbs?
Yes.
Okay, supplementary matters. I have two items to ask the board's opinion on. First one is that Mr. Joint meeting, they would like that Mr. Board of Education, they have suggested meeting, having a joint meeting on Thursday in December after our meeting. And so that'd be two meetings in a row at night. And so I suggested, why don't they come to our meeting? And they said the same thing. So
we went to their meeting last night.
I know. So here's my suggestion. Okay.
Don't be in dinner. You're in touch with dinner.
Well, I was saying it now.
For cash.
No, I was saying.
The government can do it.
I like to push it out. We're not discounting a joint meeting, but we need to come up with one night. And since both boards are going to may or may not change radically in January, I'm suggesting we should do it early next year. So.
Could we do it a night when we don't have a board meeting?
We could.
Because you never know how long it's going to go.
Right. That's my suggestion. We're not tied into doing it at our meeting time or their meeting time. We could do it at a date between when the meetings are. That's perfectly fine. But trying to do something between now and Christmas, I think is just problematic. Plus, the purpose of this is to get to work with each other. And there's going to be membership changes. Let's try to get the new members in. It's going to help them more than anything.
Okay.
Is there a formal agenda? Is there a formal agenda?
No, there's not. Generally, what we do, we'll come up with items that affect both boards. Like we've been talking, Tim, about, you know, we're going to close, they're going to close the bridge, another bridge.
Right.
In 2019, we've had discussions with that.
Right.
We've had discussions with, like, our schedule. So there's been joint things. So what the boards will do is come up with items that you would like to talk to them about and items they want to talk to us about. Okay. So that's my suggestion, because otherwise we have to find a date that works for both people.
January is easier anyway, yeah.
Yeah.
I agree 100%.
Yeah. Yeah, so I mean.
That makes sense.
It's just here for
you. Well, I think Mindy had her hand up before me. Did you have your hand up?
No.
I'm I know I'm probably in the minority, but why are we waiting so long? I just don't understand.
Because, first of all, the calendar between now and Christmas is really going to fall. And we have to find a time, and you don't meet two nights in a row. Unless you want to meet two nights, and I think the board doesn't want to meet two nights in a row.
And is there a pressing issue that you think?
No, I just.
I think we're all for it, but it's just that.
No, but he's also going to have three, well, we have, may have new people, and.
And the Veterans Board is changing.
It's on my calendar, Ken.
Could I?
That Veterans Board.
I.
And they may have new people.
Yeah, I don't, new people are new, you know? The old people.
They're old.
Old people have a lot of experience, and,
We're old, what can I say?
I think it's valuable to, I think it's a really good time right now, before January, to meet, because we had that, meeting last year, joint meeting last year. And I think it was, a very positive, gesture. And I think, communication between the two districts is needed and, should be nurtured and, encouraged. And I think it is very valuable for these two boards to get to know one another and to see, a face, learn from one another and, to share ideas. So I think it's a very valuable meeting. I'm being selfish because I'm not going to be around in January. And I'd love to be a part of that, joint meeting. Thank you.
So does anybody else agree with it?
Well, I know, I'm going to beat the dead horse.
It doesn't matter.
The reason why I was thinking of Bob is because it's the beginning of a school year. And my point is that we're starting with Bedminster. They're attending school, and we are one.
We can find a date. And I don't, and I'm looking at, they're asking for December.
Okay.
So.
Unless
you guys can find a date, don't forget, you know, I'm looking at my calendar. It's filled up.
One month, if you can't find a date, that's fine.
They threw out December, but December's like one of the worst months, because you're all going to have to come too, because we have, like, all the concerts.
But wasn't that the first throw-out? I mean, isn't this the beginning of a dog?
I'm just mentioning that.
Nothing is cemented.
I'm trying to get the board's opinion, what the majority would like to do.
Obviously.
And I'm hearing two people who say they want to do it earlier, and some people say, well, January is fine.
My feeling is we should wait until January. There's going to be some changes, and I think we should do it in January. That's my opinion.
For January.
And I'm sticking to it.
There's a shot.
I have no opinion.
You have no opinion, oh, come on.
Not October. I don't care. Whatever, I'm happy to meet, I'm happy not to meet.
Is there?
Just don't interfere with, like, World Series.
When we did this and set up last year, we knew the idea was to have, make this an ongoing thing. So is there a way that, for next year at least, we can coordinate the meeting dates? A lot of boards do meet twice a month. We only meet once a month. I think we do need to meet twice a month, but that's something, a totally different story. But if we can coordinate the monthly scheduled meetings so that they're on the same day, and we could, you know, it's not going to create this thing. I think I would like to see us do that for next year, so we can even do one early in the year and then one in January or February when things calm down a little bit.
So you know, the same day as our regular meeting.
The same day, so we coordinate 2 months, we coordinate the same meeting time.
Would it be before?
I don't
because
know.
Like, I'm sure their meetings, you don't know how long they're, you never know what's going to come up from the public.
Right.
Or how long you're going to be there.
They meet on different days, though. Don't we meet on Wednesdays and Thursdays?
Or we could have a second meeting that month, each board, a second meeting that month, and it's devoted to that. The second meeting, one, two times a year. I mean, I'd like to see us a home and home, like they're doing.
I agree with you. We could just set up, whether we meet once or twice a month, doesn't matter, but we could set up, like, in October, we meet on one day with, one night with the Bedminster Board, and one day in June or March or April or the end of the school year and just set up our calendars that way.
You know, we can set that up in June.
Whether it's a.
When we're planning our meetings for the next year.
For the next year, and when we do our calendar, just put in 2 days and we're.
But I think the meeting has to be, the meeting has to be not a, a discussion meeting, not a.
It's not a board meeting.
If it's the second board meeting of the month, it would be a perfect opportunity. So if we can do that now, we can, as a board philosophically agree that the early in the school year, like Mindy is saying, kickoff kind of a meeting, and then January, February, just to see how things are going. And both meetings accomplish what we're looking to do, and that's to work more closely with amendments to board.
And I think actually, now that I've given some thought, I think that the Bedminster Township Board of Education was sort of honoring my last few months on the board, and that's why they put a push for meeting for January.
Anyway, we'll look for a meeting in January.
Great, thanks a lot.
All right, I would just like to ask something. If Julie can tell us when that meeting is, I would like to go to that meeting in Bedminster.
The what meeting?
Your last meeting.
Oh, it's, thank you, I'll tell you.
Okay.
I know I said it before, but I'll just say it one more time and then I swear I'll be quiet. I just think that, I know that Bedminster, and I spoke to the superintendent, she was thrilled that she had an opportunity to meet with us because it's not, you know, we service those children. And she's vested in this school, you know, and.
We're only talking a few weeks here, so.
But nobody's saying that we shouldn't.
No, but a few weeks in education, though, is huge. I mean, as a learning consultant in a school district, 1 month is huge as an educator. 1 month is huge. 2 months is huge. 2 weeks in five life is huge, Bob. So.
I think no best interest, I don't care. Whatever everyone wants to do, I'm talking about. I just want to say, Julie, I just want to remind everybody too that our administrations talk weekly, Franny. I mean, monthly, we meet. I mean,
well,
not like
Bedminster asks to go to every other month.
Yeah.
I have an email from them asking, because we initiated the every month meeting. And this year, they asked if we could go to every other month because, like you said, there's so much to do that we were on top of each other when we were every month. So we are going to go.
No, my point isn't just that there were meetings.
Yeah, we do.
She wants to make sure things are coordinated, working for
the
board.
And
I think they are. It's just that it's more informational for the board is really what it ends up being. I mean, there might be a hot issue, the bridges or whatever needs to be discussed or whatever. You know, but generally speaking, it's just more of a sharing of information. Because really what you're doing the hard work with the administrators, and that's what you're supposed to do.
And also you have the sharing of information, as you said, Nancy, with the board members, which are a larger number than the administrators in both schools. So there's an opportunity for more ideas and more discussion, and it's very positive, I think.
No, I'm all for it.
Yeah. I'm not saying you're not.
I'm not.
You don't have to.
I'm down
with it.
I just have to come up with
no
idea.
Yeah.
All right, so we'll go back and suggest a date in January that's between scheduled board meetings where we can meet and it's like a board retreat type thing, publicly notify it, publicly notice it, and we won't conduct any action that night.
And then after that, next year, we'll plan ahead for two meetings.
So how to schedule
really
it as a regular schedule.
We have a fall and a spring meeting.
Yeah, early.
Why don't we
early
do it during reorg? Then we set the meetings, whatever part of the year we set the meetings.
Yeah,
clear.
That's
usually
April, May.
You could put on the schedule for next year.
Good, yeah.
Right. The second item I have, we talked about strategic planning, and so to get that going, I need to ask for volunteers from the board. I need at least four volunteers the, let me explain what the job is. Don't volunteer. The job is, the job of this ad hoc strategic planning committee is to select the stakeholders, which will be asked, and round up, whether it's 25 people, 30 people, whatever number you think, between now and February. That was the goal. And then from the springtime, we would then develop a strategic plan in the 12 months. So I need volunteers who, and I need at least four, so we'll do that. So Lou, you still volunteering?
Yes, I am.
I saw his hand up.
Yeah, what do you envision, a lot of meetings?
Well, I would say the first...
Only because October, November, I'm going to be...
I know, it's a busy time.
Yeah.
I would say you would need at least one or two meetings between now and Christmas. The first thing, the group would decide, here are the people that we think. Then you have to ask them.
Right.
And like if I ask somebody in the community, if I ask like Esther, she might say no. So I got to go to somebody else.
I nominate Esther.
But since Esther's been here, I might ask her. But those are the kind of thought processes we go through. So the group of four or five people, maximum out of five, and so it needs to go through and come up with names. And
I think you should have one from each community.
I agree with you, yes.
So
I'm just going to help you.
No, I mean, there could be another person from another community.
How many people do I need to get?
I volunteer too, because I think you can get you and the other three.
Yeah, exactly. I was being volunteer. No, I'm happy to volunteer.
Okay, so we got Tim, Greg, and Jamie,
and Mindy.
And Mindy. And that's fine. I mean, we can't have any more than five because then it becomes a board meeting.
Can I just ask a question?
Sure.
Why
do
you think
it's
25 people?
So example, on the committee, once you decide, so obviously you're going to ask the superintendent, these two people will probably have to say yes,
Well, is the committee have any charter, or is it up to the committee?
It's up to the committee. I would look at what we did the last time. So, example,
right.
We would ask, is the principals? You don't have to get all three principals, maybe two, maybe one.
Right.
Because I know we had Amy the last time.
We had all the principals last time.
I think we had all the principals. But it's not cast in stone.
Right.
So if this group would elect their chairman and then come up with a... Who are you going to ask, and then you divide the work. So each person asks five people, you're going to get 25 people.
Oh, we only need to pick the five.
I wouldn't go more than 30 people, because if you have a room of 30 people, it gets very tired.
Okay? Well, I would imagine it would be conducted with 30 people in an open discussion. I think you probably have subgroups, but... Yeah, I think it sounds like what you're saying is this group would be the steering committee, which would define the roadmap for how they propose to set out the strategic plan.
And right? Keep in mind, those 25 people will then not be on any of the subcommittees that are...
The action committees.
So if you want to be really involved in the strategic plan, on the action part of it, don't be part of this.
Although you did come up with a topic, though.
Is there any rules to how it plays out, or the requirements?
Well, the strategic plan, once it gets written up, I envision in 2018, the board, whoever's sitting here, has to approve it.
No, I'm just wondering, so the process for developing the strategic plan, that's to be defined by the steering committee, correct?
Right.
And I would involve... The school boards, I think, should be helping us with this.
We would want to... a facilitator. Last time, Tim, we hired a facilitator. I recommend using, it's the New Jersey School Boards. They have a person to do this, and they have a guideline how they do it for other schools. So they would help you through it. And so I would say the five of you should then reach out to them and ask for somebody to come and
have to hire them, Bob. I think you.
We physically have to hire them, so I would say, the five people should ask how much is it, is it going to cost? And do you think we can do it in the year's time? And then come back to the board and say, here's the cost, here's what it'll do, and then we'll approve it, and then you go.
Well, the thing I would also suggest too, just from what we did last year or last time, is that, you know, it's not so much, obviously you have to get, you know, people, whatever, to be on it. Sometimes you almost have to define the types of people that you want on it, you know? You know, whether it's clergy people or people who are involved with, you know, different volunteer stuff in the communities. You try to have maybe a representative from, you know, municipal government from every single one of the community. You know, I mean, you sort of have to define the types of people that you really want to be part of the steering committee, and then you go out and find them.
The last time we had different groups, so maybe once we identify the groups.
No, it was one group at a time. What happens is this one, that's the steering committee, that's the big committee that sort of comes up with each individual plan. And then what happens is then you appoint the chair people that are each individual action committee, you know, like whatever. You know, and then those people are not, but they're not part of the steering committee. The steering committee isn't a part of any of the action committees. So, you know, I'm saying, you just want to get everyone in the steering, because they're really sort of defining the big picture about all the different things you're going to cover. So you want to make sure it's well represented of different people, because not all boards will be going to people from all over.
And then we should probably have a facilitator that oversees that one initial
board group. That'll be school.
That'll be school board, yeah.
That'll be school board. So I'll let the five, if the five of you can meet sometime in the next, few weeks.
Who's the five?
Lou, Greg, Jamie, and Mindy.
Thank you.
All right, so five.
Are you on it?
Yeah.
No, I'm not. I mean.
Who's the fifth then, you?
It's Mindy, Greg, Jamie.
Bob's not on.
And Nancy promised to be sort of the honorary chairman.
Nancy is not.
Oh, no.
I've just volunteered to be honorary chairperson.
No, I will.
And by the way, me.
I will be a consultant from a bar. Lou was on the street the last time, you know.
Yeah, I was on it too.
He was president at the time.
I need to remember that. Now I remember that.
Okay, I'm done.
I have two issues, actually, I have three. Bob covered the one, that was with the Bedminster. Number one is the committee reports. My suggestion is, I don't think we need to have a great big discussion on it tonight, but I would really like to see us go back to the written committee reports so we have something in writing so that ahead of time, if we have a report, we can read it, and then we could ask some questions. But I think when I was chairman of the finance committee, I didn't, quite frankly, through confessions, I didn't enjoy writing all the reports, but I think it's helpful for us to get those written reports of the committee meetings when they meet, and you have it sent out a couple of days, two, 3 days after. So I'd like us to consider that, number one. Number two, I know we're going to have some discussion with Franny on this one, but I'm, like everybody on this board, very happy to see the student there. Thank you very much, Sarah, for your suggestion with that. The only thing I would like to see, I'd like it to be a productive relationship with the student. What I always envisioned was the student not sitting up on the dais, but at least being involved at the board meetings, bringing us information, having him here. I know tonight's a later meeting than we usually go, but if we could have Scott work with some of his teachers, maybe not to give a lot of homework that night, because he would be, but I'd like to see him here, because I think there are a lot of times during this meeting, we discussed a lot of things. I think it was a very healthy, productive meeting tonight, that we could have gone to him and, what's his name again?
Fred.
I think we could have gone to Fred and asked him his opinion, what he thought, what he thinks the students feel. So I don't think asking a senior to be out till 9 o'clock is too, you could disagree, and I'm sure you will, but it's not late. They do, if they're in a sport, they're not getting home till 10 o'clock. And if you think they're going to bed before 11 o'clock most nights, that's not the case. But if the principal can work with him, I think it would be healthy and productive if he could stay a little bit and interact a little bit. That's my thought.
Who's being called on here?
I just have one observation, which I think is great happening here. I think it's awesome. I don't know if we want to put a student on the spot to on-the-fly respond to a dialogue at the board. I think that would be a very awkward and probably inappropriate. I mean, I think it's a great idea, but I just don't think we want to put him on the spot. And then it would chill the whole dialogue.
That's well taken. I don't disagree with that. I think just if he's here and if he doesn't interact with us, then at least he's hearing what we're saying. And he could bring that back to the student body.
I think what he did was absolutely perfect. I mean, they do, you know, they're in academics, they're in sports, they need a little bit of a social life, and they do have to go to bed. And even though, like you say, like they're not going home and going to sleep, there is a period of relaxation time so that you can sleep. So I think what we saw tonight was a really perfect.
If I may, I understand what you're saying, because in Bridgewater we do have a student on board. They do sit, and when they want to contribute, they can. You know, they do. I think it is extremely valuable. I've seen a lot of them come out of it. You know, but it is very valuable.
What did we come up with? I think what happened tonight was good.
You know, I don't know if they want to go and.
Even if it's at his discretion, you know, if he wants to stay, he can stay. If he, you know, if he has a midterm or a final, he can go.
Are we done with the student thing?
No, I got one comment. Like when we had the discussion about the service hours and things like that, maybe that's something that can go back to the student rep and get maybe some kind of input. When we do that discussion, or maybe he should be one of the 25 people on the one of the 25 in our group.
So now we only need 24.
Now we only need 24. So you know.
Okay.
Do the five of us count in the 25 now?
Yeah.
So were you going to talk about the students?
For 15.
Yeah.
Are you going to
I agree with you that I think we just have to be careful because you don't want to put him on the spot. He should be the one to go back and get the information. The other thing I need to check with Scott, because I know that the kids were asking if that was a requirement to stay for the whole board meeting.
Yeah.
That's where that got generated from, just FYI.
And if they don't want to stay, that's fine. Tim's point is very well taken, believe me. I agree.
So that ties to my comment, which is we talked about this in my first meeting, but I feel very strongly that we need to move the public comment period, unless it's prescribed by law, to the front of the meeting, not the back of the meeting. I mean, these guys have been awesome sitting here, those who want to talk, until, you know, we're 2 hours into what's become a very long meeting. And I just think if we want to get people engaged in the board, which we do, we want to make it easy for them, which we should be doing. So let's move that, whatever is required, unless it's a legal requirement, I strongly suggest that we move it to the front of the meeting.
Let me respond to that. There's pros and cons of that, and I made an error tonight. Does anybody have any public comments? Okay. So, I did make an error. But
yeah, it's always after stuff.
Generally, if there's a lot of public here to talk, then it's best to do it at the end, because we'll never get through our meeting. That's our experience. I ask any of the board meeting. And I thought our meeting was going to be short, so that's the mistake I made tonight. So it could go either way. So I think procedurally we should keep it the way it is, but make the judgment each night.
Yeah, I mean, or you can time limit the front end session.
I just think
it provides a significant dampening effect on people's willingness to attend board meetings.
I know Esther, and I can't remember
Mark. I'm Sam.
No, your name.
Sam.
Yeah. So they come to all the meetings because they enjoy them, okay? So I'm cognizant of that because I've been sitting there too.
No, I get it. I mean, I've heard it from innumerable people.
And it can go both ways. I've seen it go, it's been a train wreck the other way. Because you'll be here at midnight. And having got to the board agenda. I made the judgment that our agenda was going to go pretty quickly tonight, but it did, which is fine. Because sometimes you have discussion, like when we met last month, we were done in an hour, so, okay?
Okay, not that I'm eager to write reports ahead of time, but I suppose if people have the committee information earlier, maybe the discussions wouldn't be as long. Because everybody's reacting to news that they didn't know about. And so if you had it, then, you know.
It may generate more questions, which is a good thing.
Maybe, but you wouldn't have the learning about it part.
Now, don't forget, it only works for a couple of committees.
I know, you can't write about personnel.
You can't write about personnel, you can't write about FNO because we just had it, so.
Right.
So it only boils down to curriculum and policy.
Right.
Fine.
May I comment on the writing of the comments for our meetings? I think one of the important parts about taking notes for our meetings is that we have a history also. And I think it's very important that we document what we say in our committee meetings because we don't always know what we've done in the past and what works and what doesn't work. You know, like, for example, what we discussed at today about our service learning and why did we make this a graduation requirement? You know, what was the thoughts behind it? You know, just an example, but you know, we have to have a history here. Burns High has been here forever. You know, there's so many wonderful things that we've done here. You know, so many wonderful decisions have been made, and why? We don't have any proof of anything. Who made so many boards have come and gone, and we have no record.
Well, who's been here? So
yeah, you know, like, well, you. Yeah, I know you have a memory, but you know, you get kind of old. Sorry. But you know, like, you can't spit out everything, and I think it's very important that we have a record, a running record, just because I might not be elected in 2 years. You might move. Like,
it's online. That would have to be online for somebody to access. You can't just have a sack of papers in a corner. Who goes?
I got a trunk full.
I know, but can you find it?
Well, I'm just saying, like, to start curriculum, I just think we all need, I just think we need records. Tim, your first question, which I admired so much the first day we met you, the first question you asked was, do you take notes at your committee meetings? I will never forget that, and I thought, wow, it's got to happen together.
I didn't know.
You did, and I thought, you know what, it's very important. It's very important.
Can I say one thing about that?
No.
I'll just say one thing and then we're probably going to wrap up. The only thing is that a lot of times what happens in committee is a death purpose of committees. You have discussion. You don't take any action in a committee. All you do is make recommendations to the full board. It's fine, but I just think that sometimes things are discussed that, you know, there's no decisions that have been made, and when things are actionable, you bring it to the board and the board votes on it. So therefore, then it becomes part of the record. And you can look at any record. You could go back in minutes for 20 years and find out what the board voted on different things. I think the board just needs to care about. I don't really care personally because it's not going to really, you know, down the road what will really affect me. But I'm just saying, I just think that sometimes it's one of those ideas. Sometimes I think it sounds good to do it, but then the reality of it, sometimes I think it's troublesome. That's all.
I was saying you would want to really know what was being said and the dynamic in the conversation. That means that somebody who's writing that down's got to really take copious notes. Whereas now we have topics and then you can speak on them. So.
We don't need to make a decision there. But again, New Jersey School Board's guidance recommended. Just so it knows.
I will do it for the Finance Committee coming up as a trial. How's that sound?
In November?
From November to March. Okay, because that, we'll have that.
I'll think about it.
You know, we'll have that either week before or whatever it is. We'll see how it goes. And if people like it, find it helpful, we'll continue it and we'll expand, okay? Is that okay?
We can change this and else.
Can I?
So you can take the.
We put this notice, I believe that was a charity.
I agree.
Right. Talked about having meetings twice a month.
Again, New Jersey School Board recommends that, I don't know that.
That's without minutes.
That's without. And then you're running, you're trying to understand.
I just thought something came up and somebody else wanted to do something and then we had to put in an agenda, you know what I mean? So.
So you don't have 12:30, so you have to use your water meeting and working committee for your other meetings. That was your one year.
All right. If there's no other comments, are there any other comments?
I'm going to just, I want to do one little shout out.
Sure, okay.
I went last week to see the, I just wanted to give a shout out to the high school guidance counselors, students and parents, and administrators that were involved in the freshman orientation night. I thought that was really great. You were there. I mean, I thought they did a really nice job in welcoming the incoming freshmen, explaining the ropes. The kids really did a good job that were in my session, and I thought that was a great thing.
Oh, thank you. You know what? They have really worked hard.
Yeah, it was great. They broke us into little groups.
I'm glad.
Yeah, that's great. Your guidance counselor, and I mean, I know it's good for freshmen, but it was, I think, particularly helpful for the Bedminster kids who weren't here in the district already to ask questions and get familiar with everything, so I thought it was great.
Good, thank you.
I'll pass that along, definitely.
I'll make a motion to adjourn. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Okay, all right.